finally, opening statements from both sides in the Michael Jackson case. And from Judge Rodney Melville, the 10-count child molestation and conspiracy indictment read with a list of 28 alleged overt acts, some involving booze and sex, graphically described. Then, DA Tom Snedden came out swinging, saying Jackson exposed the teenage boy in this case to, quote, strange sexual behavior. Strange behavior which threatened to leave the confines of the Neverland Ranch, according to Snedden. When on February 3rd of 2003, and I quote, Michael Jackson, the defendant in this case, his world was rocked. And it didn't rock in a musical sense, it rocked in a real life sense. Snedden went on describing a desperate Jackson and five unindicted co-conspirators obsessed with trying to restore Jackson's public image. But according to Snedden, the video did not make it easy. Snedden described what the accuser's little brother would describe. Let me warn you, this is graphic. Quote, how on other occasions he happened upon seeing Michael Jackson masturbating himself with one hand while Jackson's other hand was inserted into the underpants of his brother. The private world of Michael Jackson reveals that instead of bedtime discussions and children's books and discussions of Peter Pan, that this 44-year-old man is sharing his collection of sexually explicit magazines. That he's talking to the accuser about masturbation. He's telling him it's normal and that it's okay and everyone does it. That each of these acts is calculated to desensitize the boy, to change his moral antenna, and to add the trust and the admiration of an adult voice to the boy's conduct to convince him what was being done was all right in the adult world, and it worked.
The question is, these are his statements. These are Tom Snedden's statements. We know how passionate he is about this, rightfully or wrongfully. The issue is, Dan, whether or not these witnesses, whether it's the young boy, his brother, or the flight attendant, are going to have the information and the testimony to back this up. Rhetoric is what's ruling today. Let's see what the evidence has to accomplish, though.
It seems it's really going to come down to the credibility of this boy and his brother, because no one else witnessed the molestation.
Clearly, the jury has to believe the boy in this case. I mean, he is the linchpin of the case.
You know, this is a situation where, without a doubt, the credibility of the mother and the credibility of each of the boys that are testifying about what happened to them and what they saw is paramount. And I believe that based upon what we heard today about a paralegal saying that the mother admitted that she lied in the JCPenney case, would have a tremendous effect on her credibility. So I think that Snedden's going to have a problem in this case in putting forth the evidence that's going to support his opening statement, because, you know, the evidence just doesn't come in like you say it in an opening statement or like you write it in a police report.
And what the defense wants to do is put the mother and slap it together with the rest of this family and say she's the one, in essence, concocting all of this.
You know what? This is so frustrating for prosecutors across the country. Let's not forget that it's the boy's father who went to jail for 6 months for beating the mother. It's the boy's father who beat the boy and his sister and brother. And that's the only person who's been convicted of anything in this case. So what if the mother sued JCPenney? JCPenney is going to pay out money.
And lied? Wait, and lied about it? That's okay? That's not relevant?
Did the judge say she lied? Who is this paralegal? I want to know who this person is. Is this somebody who worked for the defense, for JCPenney?
It's someone who worked for her own attorney. Yeah, I don't know. I got to tell you, this is not nothing. This is significant in this case.
They're going to trash the mother.
It's more than just trashing. The trashing the mother suggests that it's without merit.
In opening statements, apparently, prosecutors are going to be playing a clip from the Martin Bashir documentary. Bashir is likely to be the first witness. Is that a good start for the prosecution?
It's a very smart move from the prosecution, because that's probably the most compelling evidence the prosecution has in this case. It also displays his lifestyle, which is really, really off the wall, and most people sitting on this jury are going to start
with
the assumption.
Because there are six mothers on that jury, Donald. The accuser's mother, I should say. She made up charges of abuse against JCPenney, lied under oath in a civil lawsuit over it, admitted she coached her son to lie.
But this mother has secondary gain here, that she has credibility issues, that she doesn't tell the truth, that it's all about money, and that she lies.
a mystery witness and a bombshell charge aimed right at the accuser's mother.
An attorney for Michael Jackson and a deputy prosecutor each interviewed a female paralegal in a downtown L.A. office building. She worked with an attorney representing the mother of Jackson's accuser in a case 5 years ago. The paralegal says the mother told her she lied about being abused by a security guard at JCPenney's to get money from Penney's. But Jackson's lead attorney, Tom Mesereau, plans to quote the paralegal as saying the mother told her harm would come to her from the Mexican mafia if she ever told anyone of the mother's admission of fraud.
She has really no motive to come forward now except to get the truth out.
The prosecution will say because it's a dysfunctional family doesn't mean that the molestation did not occur.
Opening statements provide the first opportunity to hear on the record the prosecution's case against Jackson. Prosecutors will attempt to portray Jackson as a classic child sexual predator.
Why did you come here?
I came here to represent All Comedy Radio's news division.
Admitted that she lied.
JCPenney is going
to lied under oath.
And that she lies.